Hello, I'm Christopher Vespia. Welcome to another edition of Mastery. Today we're going to talk about drug and alcohol abuse. So I have a history with drugs and alcohol, not in particular me being an abuser, but of course I've been down the road where I've tried many things. But my history dates back to family. I grew up in a family that was dysfunctional family, and my family members, many of different family members, were addicted to one or another of drugs or alcohol. My dear mother was an alcoholic for as long as I could remember. Her drink or weapon of choice was vodka. She used to drink it all the time. I loved my mother to death, but when she was drunk, it was like a Dr. and Jekyll and Mr. Hyde kind of thing. She would become a completely different person. It was a nightmare growing up in the house where you would have to deal with a mother that was not the mother that you know all the time. So other family members, sisters and brothers, were addicted to different things. Alcohol, one of my other sisters, brandy was her drink of choice. My brother was addicted to marijuana. My other sisters tried everything from cocaine to weed to drinking, etc., etc. Strangely enough, this cycle sort of missed my youngest sister, myself, and my father. We just kind of didn't really fall into that trap, so to speak. As the years have gone on, however, things have changed, which I'll touch base on that in just a few moments. I lost family members. Mom died from the alcoholism. My sister died from the alcoholism. My other sister committed suicide when she was under the influence of something. My brother was involved in marijuana and also steroid abuse, and was involved in a situation there where he was murdered based on those situations. So it was a very difficult time growing up, something that you never forget. People say, well, why aren't you over it yet? Just like when you get divorced or something. It's been a while, so how come you're not okay? But I don't think something like that you ever really get over or turn out to be okay with. Moving out of my childhood into adult years, myself and also my sister too, from time to time, the two of us that weren't affected by such things, we decided to partake a little bit here or there in alcohol. We tried it. I know that both of us, in fact, definitely me, I've been drunk on many occasions. But over the course of this evolvement, I decided that I would live under the credo that in moderation. So I wanted to live my life, so I would try different things. I was at one point, I tried acid, and I was awake for 3 days on this. It was wild. I don't recommend it. It was very bizarre. You're not in control of yourself, just like with drinking or whatnot. Over this last Christmas holiday, I drank to excess to where I vomited until I couldn't vomit anymore. From mixing different hardcore alcoholic drinks with beer and so on and so forth, and a little weed as well. I threw up until I injured my throat in the process. My throat was injured for 3 weeks. It wasn't in the canal where you get a sore throat like when you've been sick, but I pulled a muscle or something in my throat, all because I wanted to drink to excess on Christmas. Over the last 6 months or so, I've been involved with somebody that was mentoring me in spirituality. And sometimes with spirituality, they go hand in hand, that you seek more eye-opening things. And for some, getting involved with drugs or maybe alcohol, it's supposed to open up your third eye to more spiritual natures. I know in a lot of cultures, they use a drug called ayahuasca to do this. I've been reading a book lately. Let me show this to you here. I have this book here, which is called The Teachings of Don Juan. This was recommended to me, a Yaqui Way of Knowledge. And in this book, it talks about mescalito, which is peyote. It's supposed to be a friend to you to open up your spiritual concepts. Something called the devil's weed and the little smoke are spoke of in here. And it all starts to become very alluring, especially when you're getting deep into spirituality, as I have been. I've been studying Buddhism and getting more and more in tune with Christ and different things. So my friend or mentor decided that it was a good idea for me to start experimenting with some other things. He offered to me mushrooms, which I never did ultimately take. And we went down the road of taking dextromethorphan, which is, they call it M80s, it's a street drug. But it's meth. It's what you find in cough syrup, but it's meth on a small scale. It's a meth type of drug. So, and that's hence my appearance today. I'm Heisenberg. Damn it, Jesse! We have to cook the meth! So, the meth or dextromethorphan that we took, basically you're overdosing on the same medicine that they put in cough syrup. And at first, I did it twice. The first time it felt like there was an ecstasy there, that I was actually feeling or seeing different spiritual patterns or different things. But there's a sickness that comes with it, especially when it's not a natural drug. You're overdosing on drugs per se, and you can feel your stomach's getting sick, your face is getting very hot, you're basically poisoning yourself, worse than any alcohol you could ever poison yourself with. So over the course of the New Year holiday, this drug was taken, alcohol was taken. I mentioned to you about the vomiting on Christmas. And now we have the New Year's, where my friend drank to excess, and he turned into a totally different person, screaming and shouting. He was angry, and he actually left me at a party and just went about his own way due to the poison of the alcohol. Now we come to this last couple of days ago, where we decided to take DXM or M80s. And, you know, I didn't want to do it again, but, you know, not really peer pressure, but just, you know, you're with your friend and we're trying to rekindle our relationship after the New Year's. And here we are, you know, trying to be spiritual. And at first it was all good. I mean, I seem to have a pretty good tolerance for these different things. I wasn't throwing up this time. I didn't really feel that sick. I mean, I felt like almost a rash from the heat from this thing. You get very dizzy. But, you know, we were able to go into some martial arts, Qigong and different things, and really start feeling the world. At this point, he decided to add marijuana into the mix, because I guess that amplifies the drug. And I had a pretty good trip, I guess you could call it, although the entire time I could really feel as though I was very sick, because this is a drug, a chemical. Putting that much chemical in your body, I mean, if I were going to do anything, I would prefer, you know, the peyote or the mushrooms or the weed, something. It's probably even better than the alcohol, because it's a mixture of chemicals. It's a poison. So I passed out, and my friend did not. Something kept him wired. I kept opening my eyes slightly to see him hovering around the room and different things. And he kept smoking weed hardcore. All of a sudden, I was awakened to the sound of him screaming at the top of his lungs, "Somebody play with me!" And I looked up, I said, "What is going on?" And at that point, he started kicking me, light kicks while I was lying down, because I was lying down on the floor in his house. And he kept just saying, "Play with me, play with me, play with me, play with me," and he just kept kicking me. "Play with me, play with me." And I was like, "Dude, shut up, I'm trying to sleep. Come on, lay down, I want to sleep this off." At the time, I didn't know that he had excessively smoked the weed. So he's, "Play with me, play with me." So I was like, "All right, I'll play with you." I got up and we went over to the dining room area. And at that point, he gave me an embrace and he hugged me for, it must have been about 4 minutes. And I just really felt that he was very lonely, as if he really needed someone in his life. He's always been a very strong person that I know of, especially spiritual. But maybe there is a weakness inside that sometimes we break down. And when I released him, I remember him making a motion like, you know, like, wow. Like, that hug was so nice because, you know, maybe growing up, this one didn't care about him, or that one doesn't care about him, or whatever it was, it was very nice. But then at this point, following that, he sank into a chair in the dining room, and he basically went into the deepest meditation trance that I'd ever seen anybody go into in my life. Basically, he was slightly comatose. He even peed himself. I was shocked when all of a sudden he peed his pants and peed on the ground, which is why I'm not mentioning any names here. It happens. At that point, I became slightly uncomfortable because I thought, okay, the last time he woke me up, and it was very bizarre. He was beating a drum and screaming and kicking me. And so if I were to lay down again, and I was tired, I'm an older man. This kind of hit me a little hard, and I hadn't slept earlier that day anyway. But I thought, how's he going to wake me up the next time? I mean, he was definitely different than when he drank the alcohol on New Year's, where he became volatile and violent. He was very serene and calm, but it was very bizarre, his behavioral patterns. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to leave. I was going to stay, just like on New Year's, where I felt like I needed to take care of him, but he was, because he decided to smoke more, he was in a trip that I wasn't in, and I thought it was better to just let him trip it out. At this point, I've read a few things online where if somebody's in that state, they should be watched. I felt kind of bad leaving him, but like I said, he was cognitive enough to hug me and sit down. I hope he's okay at this point. I'm sure he is. I've been told by other friends that he is. So, I mean, one of my friends said that I shouldn't feel guilty for his choices. But I mean, I didn't want to leave my friend, but I could see the rest of the evening being extremely difficult for me. I couldn't sleep, and I really didn't want to be high anymore. I wanted to get these toxins out of me, and I was like, I need to lie down and sleep, because I had made the decision that was it. I didn't want to do it anymore. Once was enough, twice was enough. And this is the reason for this video, because if you go down this road, peer pressure becomes an easy thing to follow. Pattern becomes an easy thing to follow. Caring about someone and then you want to do what they're doing. I know a young lady who dated the individual that I'm speaking of, that says that she and my friend had done this DXM every weekend for over a year or more. And she doesn't seem, you know, I'm not judging anybody, but she doesn't seem like the kind of person that would do something like that unless it was, you know, peer pressure or following. I mean, I don't know. But my reason for this video is now a warning. It's easy to get caught in a trap. You try a cigarette when you're a child, and then all of a sudden you're addicted to cigarettes. You try your first beer, and now you're an alcoholic. You try some drugs, and you're a drug addict. I'm strong enough in character that I have decided on the spot that I'm not going to touch any more of these things. Even as interesting as this book is, and it was swaying me to think, you know, maybe this is a good way to get into my spiritual world. You're not really getting into a spiritual world. Even the Native Americans, when they would smoke and go into the spirit world, it is a different plane. It is a different vibration of mind, but I don't believe that you're actually going into the spirit world. I think a better way to go into the spirit world would be through your meditation practice, whatever your beliefs are. You know, I guess the Yaqui Native Americans believed that if you were seeing it, then you were on that level, and yet your body was just laying on the bed on drugs. So I think it's hallucinations. Whatever it is, it's not for me. I've decided that it's not for me, and I don't think it should be for you. I think that meditation is key. I think that exercise, there's something called a runner's high or an ecstasy when you work your cardiovascular system to the point of euphoria, that can get you high. Be high on life. I think it is a good thing to be spiritual. Be high on the spirit. Praise Jesus, praise Buddha, praise Allah, praise Krishna. Be high on life. Don't take drugs. Drugs are bad. I know I sound like an after-school special, but don't drink, particularly to excess. Be all you can be and be aware of your life now as it is at all times. Be alive in the spirit. If you need to visit that spiritual plane, I don't think that you need these extras to get there. I believe meditation is key because I've experienced similar awakenings during Native American ceremonies or meditation. Whatever it is, it's bad for your body temple. You wouldn't throw dirt in your house, so don't throw drugs and alcohol into your system. This is a message for today. I strongly believe in it. At one time I thought maybe it was okay with moderation. I no longer believe this after what I've experienced. And right now as we speak, 2 days after the fact, I still don't feel well. Now I have a little bit of a cough, which I'm not sure is associated with it. I have this afterglow effect where I could barely get out of bed today because I poisoned my body. So now I'm going to reverse the process. I'm going to eat right. I'm going to clean my body out. I learned a lesson. Hopefully you'll learn one too from this video. Drugs and alcohol will kill. They took many of my family members. At this very point, whether I should or not, I'm a little worried about my friend. And I'm worried about all of you. Have a good day every day. Namaste. God bless. Om. Peace. Amen. And damn it, Jesse, put away the drugs. My baby blue. That's all I have to say.